See one, two, sound check, check, check. One, testing, one, two, one, two. This is an audio test, sending audio signal, video signal from ASE to all the campuses. Testing, one, two, three. Testing, one, two, three. Would you please confirm with our director that you guys are getting the fee? Testing, one, two, sound check, one, two. All right, this is over and out. get the audio from my mic. Testing 1 2, sound check. Testing 1 2, sound check. Testing audio coming from ASC. Testing 1 2 3. Testing, testing, checking with Rio Grande, Trans Mountain, Northwest, Valle Verde, Mission del Paso. Testing 1 2, testing 1 2 3. Testing 1 2, sound check, 1 2, sound check, 1 2, sound check, 1 2. Testing 1, adjusting levels, testing 1 2 3. Adjusting levels, microphone at ASC, testing 1 2. Sound check, 1 2, sound check. Welcome, welcome to El Paso Community College. Testing 1 2, sound check. Live streaming from ASC. Testing 1 2 3, sound check.
Good afternoon, and welcome to President Dr. William Serrata's 7th Annual State of the College Address. I am Carrie Moe, the Associate Vice President of External Relations, Communication, and Development. The State of the College is a momentous and celebratory time of year. It is because of each of you sitting here today, watching at one of our 5 campuses, or streaming online, that EPCC is the best place to start and to finish. In just a few minutes, our fearless and inspiring leader, Dr. Serrata, is going to share a snapshot of the highlights from the past year and accomplishments that were made as a result of all of your combined efforts for our district. But before he does that, I want to take a few moments to go back in time. For those of you who are here at the ASC, you may have felt like you were entering a time warp as you were welcomed by a fun music playlist from 1969 that was prepared by Media Services. I hope that got you feeling a little bit nostalgic. I am thrilled to be here to share an exciting milestone for EPCC with you today. In just a few short months, we will be kicking off a celebration of our 50th anniversary. Very exciting, yeah, I think that deserves a round of applause. 50 years is an accomplishment. This celebration has been in the planning for more than a year now and would not be possible without my fabulous co-chair, Ms. Lisa Elliott. Lisa, will you please stand up? And it's really Lisa who's been doing the heavy lifting for this project, and she's doing an incredible job. And it's not just her. The organizing of this celebration is no small task, and we have enlisted more than 50 representatives from all 5 campuses and every division to help make this celebration a success. This committee has been meeting monthly, as well as participating in additional subcommittee meetings that are focusing on history, community outreach, commencement, a celebration gala, student engagement, and providing other support to this special occasion. Can the members of the committee and subcommittees please stand up, whether you're in this room or at one of your representative campuses? The 50th celebration would not be possible without their dedication and vision. Thank you so much for all you do and the time you're putting into making our celebration memorable. And EPCC's success the past 50 years wouldn't be possible without the collective contribution of all of our students and employees. El Paso Community College will officially turn 50 on June 28, 2019. This provides an exciting opportunity for a year-long celebration, beginning in January of 2019, highlighting EPCC's impact in the community and in the region. The goal of the committee has been to increase awareness of our college turning 50 and to promote the college's stability, longevity, and reinforce the reputation of our programs and services in the community. By highlighting our already great programming, partnerships, and activities, it is our goal to engage with past, current, and future students, EPCC employees, business and industry partners, and the community in celebrating our rich history and our plans for the future. We will strive for maximum visibility through advertising, earned media, social media, and a variety of community events. The goal is to have 4 signature events and to promote existing college activities, the great things that each of you do every day, every month, and every year. And to promote all of this to have commemorative activities all year long. And stay tuned, we'll have a calendar of events that will be coming out soon and an interactive website where you can find out about all of these things. 50 years of improving our community by creating strong educational opportunities for our region is incredibly significant. This is our time to brag and share our story. Let's celebrate this milestone and showcase our positive impact in the border region over the past 50 years. Next, I want to share a video with you that was created by Lisa Elliott, along with footage from EPCC TV and a lot of help from media services this morning to officially unveil our 50th anniversary logo, as well as showcase its creation that highlights our inspiring work culture and our successes.
We knew that El Paso was a large city and there were not very many opportunities for a lot of the population for higher education. I'm talking about high quality, real college, higher education. UTEP was the only game in town and a lot of people just felt like it was out of their reach financially or they didn't belong there or whatever. So we had this idealism, this idea that we can create a college for the community. It's a community college. Everybody can come if they can qualify with the state test and things like that.
The college allows you to do almost anything you want to do. You can be as innovative as and productive and, you know, it has no limits.
And I think that's the greatest benefit that I've learned from this institution is being able to touch them in a small way and empowering them and telling them what they can do. And then when they come back or I receive the graduation invitations to attend their graduations and things like that, those are very, very rewarding for me. Or to see the student that didn't think they could do anything and they can, and they've achieved great things. That's been the most fulfilling piece for me, I believe.
What EPCC has taught me about myself was that I could be who I wanted to be. Back in the summer of 2011, the college sent out an email to everyone asking to see if anyone was interested in creating a logo for this new department that the college was creating. And the department was going to be called EMSTI, Emerging Science and Technology Institute. Steve Smith, who was in charge of that new department, contacted me, letting me know that they chose the logo that I created. So of course I was ecstatic and excited and disbelief that they chose my logo. That really gave me the confidence in myself, knowing like, oh, maybe I can become or also be a graphic designer. That really pretty much put a fire underneath me. And in December of 2015, I graduated from UTEP, receiving my Bachelor's of Art in Graphic Design. And the following month, in January in 2016, the marketing department asked me if I would like to be part of a small committee to create the 50th anniversary logo for the college. So when I learned that my logo was chosen to be the 50th anniversary logo, it took me back to that summer of 2011 when Steve Smith chose the very first logo I created for the college and how that made me feel and how that catapulted me to continue learning and going to UTEP to study graphic design. What I really wanted to emphasize was the 50, because I think 50 years of the college being here in the community is a big deal. So I just wanted to really emphasize the 50. And I also put in the three colors, the two colors that the college uses, teal and purple, and of course gold for the 50th anniversary. And I think it just works well together. It was a great feeling knowing that I kind of came full circle, that I created my very first logo for the college. It was chosen, and then I finally went through the right steps in learning and all the design skills, and then here I am in 2016, again, one of my logos being chosen for the college. So it was a great feeling.
Thank you, Lisa and EPCC-TV. We are also very glad to have Carol Barkeen in our college community. Not only was she instrumental in developing the 50th anniversary logo, she also recorded the faculty and staff interviews featured at the beginning of the video. When you look at our logo, I hope you remember her story and how El Paso Community College has shaped who she is today, both as a student and as an employee. And she is just one example of our many student, employee, and EPCC success stories that we hope to highlight during our 50th anniversary celebration. The logo is now officially available for your use. Marketing has 50th anniversary business cards, letterhead, and other items available for order. And so we hope you order them and share them and use them proudly. There is also a page on our website where you can submit your story. Please help us make our 50th the best year yet. Now, it is my pleasure to welcome our newest vice president to the stage, the Vice President of Research, Accreditation, and Planning, Dr. Julie Penley.
Thank you, Carrie. Hi, everyone. Hi. Did you have a good morning? Good, good, good. Did you do something interesting? Good, good, good. You know, I really want to thank Dr. Sarata and the board for thinking about Professional Development Day. Every day we give 100% to our students, to our colleagues, and this day is super important because it's our opportunity to take a moment for ourselves, to recharge our batteries, to spend some time with colleagues. For my colleagues in research, accreditation, and planning, I just want to say, and some of you know what it means and some of you don't. All right. So I wanted to introduce our area and introduce our new logo. Thank you to the marketing department for helping with that. Our theme this morning in our session was changing with the changes, and there are a lot of changes going on at the college and in our area, and so I wanted to share 3.5 updates with you. Okay, he said all I had to do was click. Okay, all right. So the first update is we have a slight reorganization. We are now a family of six. We have the accreditation and compliance area under the direction of Mary Beth Hahn, institutional effectiveness under Dr. Stroud, institutional planning under Christy Frescas, and institutional research under Dr. Kay. So those should not be considered updates to you. You should know that about our area. What you may not know is that we scooched our chairs over at the table to invite room for two more folks in two more areas to join our area. And that is the Quality Enhancement Plan under Dr. Quiros and Student Learning Outcomes under Ms. Maria Gomez. So we are changing with the changes, and we will be communicating with you throughout the year and beyond about some of the things that our area is doing. Just click. There we go. The second update, had some visitors last week on behalf of our regional accreditors, Southern Association of Colleges and Schools Commission on Colleges, SAC-COC, came to spend some time with us in El Paso right after Labor Day. So we had a team of four come visit us and tour five of our high schools and one of our early college high schools. In addition to driving them all over our service region, we also had 11 of our colleagues at the college interview with the team about some of our practices with our high school partners. And they left El Paso with no recommendations for us. So that's a big old happy face. And that is a super big old happy face for me because I'm still on my probationary period, so yay. No, it is very good news. There was a lot of preparation, a lot of work, a lot of thought that went into this visit. These things don't just happen by themselves. And so I did want to take some time to thank some folks. I hope I caught everybody. Contrary to the rumors, I am only human, so if I made a mistake, I do apologize. But I do want to give a shout out to the folks on this slide. We had folks from Instruction and Workforce Education. We had, of course, Tony Badillo and her entire staff in the Dual Credit and Early College High School area. Student Enrollment Services, External Relations, Communication and Development, and the President's Office. And there's more. We also had some incredible support from Information Technology, including Aaron, who took time out of his life not only to assist with the technology, but to actually stay at the hotel to make himself available in case there were any technology emergencies. So thank you so much, Aaron. Of course, my folks, Research Accreditation and Planning, and Financial Administrative Operations, which is, of course, a huge area. Physical plant, carried stuff back and forth to the hotel, arranged for vehicles and transportation. Poor Ruben in purchasing was probably up to here with my questions about how to do this, how to do that. So thank you so much to everybody who made this happen. And again, if I missed anybody, I am truly sorry. A lot of times you might be looking at these types of slides and you think, I don't know who that is. And I would say shame on us. Not shame on you, but shame on all of us, because we all work sometimes behind the scenes, quite frankly, most of us behind the scenes. And so we may not get the accolades that we might deserve, but I do want to say thank you so much for your help in last week's site visit. The third update that I wanted to share with you is we're not done yet. We submitted, in conjunction with this site visit, we submitted a fifth-year report to Sachs in Georgia. And it's called an interim report because we're actually in a 10-year reaffirmation cycle or accreditation cycle. Well, 10 years is a long time. I mean, think about where you were and what you were doing 10 years ago. And if somebody didn't check in with you from time to time, you know, a lot can happen. So Sachs says, you know, we want to stay connected with you on a little bit more regular basis, and so we're going to do a fifth year check-in with you, much like the tenure track faculty. We have a mid-year or mid-cycle check-in. So we submitted this fifth year report earlier this week, and just like on the last two slides, where the thank yous, you know, were just flowing, every instructional area of the college was involved in one way or another. This is not something that's just done in the research accreditation and planning area. This is a college-wide effort. So again, thank you so much for your contributions and for your support. So a lot of times it's easy to think about reports being turned in and then just put on the shelf. And so a little bit of heads up of what's coming down the pipeline with our fifth year report. We are going to have some evaluators review our work, and then the report goes to the Sachs Board of Trustees for their consideration and their review. They will make that determination at their December meeting, and then they will notify us within a few weeks after that of what we need to do next. If there's anything else that they'd like additional information on or want us to do a little bit more work on, then we will certainly do that, and we will be responding as needed during the spring 2019 semester. All right. Whoop. There we go. So what is going to be happening after the report? The next phase in Sachs accreditation is to explore our next quality enhancement plan topic. So pop quiz, what is our current topic? Okay, so I heard it in the front row, and so it's good that the front row said it. It's where a lot of our board members and cabinet officers are sitting, learning about the community as a community. And it's been a terrific plan, and thank you so much to Dr. Quiroz for her work with that plan. We are starting our next plan. Dr. Quiroz will be working on some outreach to help people generate ideas for us for the next plan. We have our preparations for our 10-year report. I will be talking to you about those principles, or your vice president, or your director, or someone will be talking to you about those. I consider them kind of a long-range plan, but it's never too early to start preparing for it. And a 10-year report doesn't just happen overnight, so we will be working on that. One of the things that I do particularly want to talk with folks about is the requirements for accreditation repeatedly use the phrase ongoing evidence. Ongoing evidence of student learning outcomes, ongoing evidence of planning and assessment, ongoing evidence of fiscal responsibility. So those language or those terms are not random. And so one of the things that I want us to get into the habit of is cycles and never losing sight of those patterns, the processes, getting into the habit of a lot of these things. And there's plenty of time to talk to you about that. There we go. And so rather than thinking, oh, here's what you need to do, here's what you need to do, no. My area is here to help you. We are largely a support role. And so we're not gonna just throw you out there and say, good luck with that, we'll see you in a few years. We are going to be providing some resources for the cabinet members on the new principles. I put them in quotes because for many of us, we've been working with these principles for several months, and it's hard to remember that sometimes folks may not know what we know. So I've been trying to recalibrate the numbering of the principles and the content of the principles, and for some folks, they may not have been as embedded in those. And so we're gonna be explaining what SACS requires of us and how you can help us demonstrate that we are in compliance with each of those principles. We also have some new software. Thank you to Dr. Giron and her team for supporting the purchase of Campus Labs. It's going to help all of us with our area plans, with those of you involved in program review, those of you that will be directly involved in our accreditation efforts. So stay tuned for trainings about Campus Labs. And many of you in the room and in the campuses will be coming with us to the SACS COC annual meeting in December. This year it's in New Orleans, so there we go. And I think that's about it for right now. So I will be around. You will be hearing from me. You will be getting sick of hearing from me, but that's the way it goes. So at this point, I am going to turn it over to, I forget what the term was, our fearless and something leader, Dr. Sarata.
Thank you, Dr. Penley. Today I will try to be not fearful and not boring, but I have a lot of slides. There's so much good news to provide and to update the entire college community that it is always my pleasure to come before you and to share some of the exciting things that each and every one of you that are here in person at the ASC, those of you that are at each of my five favorite campuses, watching this being streamed. If you happen to be at home streaming it, well, we thank you for doing that as well. But there is so much to share of what you are leading Before I begin, let me thank Ms. Moe and her team. They did a great job with that video, as well as with the 50th anniversary logo. Outstanding. Let me thank Dr. Penley and her team for the great work that they have done, and I will highlight some of that work as we go forward. But before I continue, let me thank a few members. Some, this is their first to be here in person. So let me thank the chair of the board, Chair Mr. Fierro is here. Judge Haggerty is here. Ms. Solis is here, and Ms. Nahira, all members of the board. They are sitting separated, otherwise it's a quorum, and we would have had to post this, so Ed Dunbar already called. Now, they are sitting separately, but it's certainly much of what we'll discuss today and what we'll share is very much a part of the leadership and vision from the board. They set a vision of what they want us to move forward with. It is our job to execute that vision. So let's begin with what's most important. One more thing before I go into this, and what's most important is our students. But let me also thank Pam Payne. So if there's anything wrong with the presentation, it's my fault. All that's good with the presentation is because Pam created this and has been working on this for quite some time. So many thanks to Pam Payne for the great work that she did on the presentation. Absolutely. So let's begin with our students. And we work so hard every day to facilitate their success. Never by lowering the bar, always by raising the bar and raising the expectations of our students. And there are many times that our students exceed our expectations, and they'll continue to do that. And I hate to begin with a somber note, but we have to recognize a student that raised our expectations and exceeded our expectations and really was heroic as a student, not just as a student, but as a soldier, as a veteran, as a person who did two tours in Iraq. So Ms. Charisma Ashley James, passed away earlier this past month. She did two tours in Iraq, and she was killed protecting her children in a parking lot at an elementary school. She was an amazing student. We're certainly proud of her. Keep her and her family and her children in particular in your thoughts and prayers as we move forward. Kudos, I know Ms. Jones, you were very, very close to her. Kudos to Ms. Jones and SGA for donating $25,000 to the foundation to create the Charisma James Scholarship for Veterans. If you wish to, absolutely. Yeah. She epitomized everything that is right about our institution and our nation, and so let's continue to keep her memory alive and well. I want to congratulate our new Student Government Association president, that Mr. Brian Mena. So certainly excited about what he will bring to the table. And Brian, I haven't seen you in the audience, but if you're here, look forward to you being here and working with you. We have had a tradition of outstanding student government presidents in SGA. Ms. Jones, a lot of kudos to you for your guidance with them, but it shows you again the leadership that our students have. And so we really look forward to working with Mr. Mena. I was pleased to see that, you know, the ladies have done a great job, but a young man who's going to lead this as well, which is nice for them to be in that particular area as well. Our Veterans Lounge has opened at the Trans Mountain campus. So we now have a Veterans Center at the Via Verde campus, a lounge at the Trans Mountain campus. So certainly excited about that. Again, Ms. Jones and SGA, well done. They're continuing to move forward with the student book loan and the Tejano food pantry. We know our students face challenges with the cost of books, whether they're OER or online books or in physical books, but they also have issues with food. And how do you learn when you're hungry? And so our SGA is taking the lead on this particular area and moving forward with these wonderful events. Noah Dominguez. Noah won the mass communication student who won the Public Relations Association of the Southwest 2018 scholarship. Kudos to Noah for winning that scholarship. You can't see, but it's a $1,000 check that he's holding there. So we're certainly excited, and that will certainly help him with his expenses in higher education as well. So again, a kudos to the El Paso Community College cheerleaders who participated in the 2018 National Cheerleaders Association College Cheerleading Camp in Las Vegas. I know what happens in Vegas is supposed to stay in Vegas, but I'm going to share what happened with our cheerleaders. They received first place in the Advanced Large Coed Junior College Rally Routine. They were also first place in the Junior College Game Day Routine. Very, very proud of you. Congratulations. Well done. We'll continue to talk about some of our students that are also athletes. They are the NCAA Academic Teams of the Year, NJCAA Academic Teams of the Year. 16 of our 18 student athletes graduated on time. That is outstanding work. You see the GPAs from each of the respective teams, from our women's half marathon who had a 3.62 to our women's softball team that had a 3.12. You see the individual academic honors as well. Chalet had a 4.0 in addition to being a national champion. So this is amazing. AD Hinojosa and all of our El Paso Community College coaches, well done. Thank you for making sure that these are student athletes. Our program coordinator, Veronica Dominguez, as well as faculty member Rosa Loya, clinical coordinator, and Dr. Mitchell, well done. These students, they had a 100% pass rate on their national certification exams. These are incredibly difficult exams. Our faculty continue to ensure that our students are not only ready, but they're perfect. So well done. Certainly excited about that. Phi Theta Kappa. This is the most prestigious of all honor societies amongst community colleges. So the Omega Gamma chapter of Phi Theta Kappa held their induction ceremony on the 27th of April, and 118 new members were inducted. Again, it is the most prestigious of all community college honor societies. I know because I'm only an honorary member. The students do the hard work of earning the grades to ensure that they're there. So well done and excited about that. Want to turn and highlight some of our employees. Now, I could highlight every single one of our employees, but let me highlight a couple of them. Dr. Maria Alvarez is the ACCT, the Association of Community College Trustees. Texas, believe it or not, falls in the Western region. She is the Western region winner for faculty members amongst that. We will find out, absolutely, Dr. Alvarez, we're certainly excited about that. She will be recognized as the winner of the Western Region next month in New York City, and we will find out if she is the national winner. But her work with students in the RISE program is outstanding. We were certainly pleased to submit her as an application, and her work speaks for itself. She will receive that. Dr. Pacheco, a faculty member at EPC at the Northwest Campus, he will be honored as a Minority Access National Role Model at the Minority Access Incorporated Conference. Certainly excited for Dr. Pacheco, well-deserved, and very, very happy again that you'll be honored for that particular award. These are the kind of faculty members that we have and that our students are fortunate to have and to be able to take coursework from them. Dean Joshua Villalobos. Dean Villalobos, a campus dean at Mission del Paso campus, received the Presidential Award of Excellence. Not from me, from the President of the United States. So well done, Dean Villalobos. We're certainly excited about that, absolutely. It is the Presidential Award for Excellence in Science, Mathematics, and Engineering. He received that in June of 2018. Certainly a prestigious honor, and congratulations again. I want to congratulate Angeles Vasquez as well as Sal Moreno. They have both gone through Data and Decisions Academy that is put on by Achieving the Dream. They went forward and took a rigorous curriculum of courses while they were away and doing this. They both successfully finished that. All this does is strengthen our capacity, their capacity, and their respective jobs to continue to provide really good data for us to make tough decisions. So the data informs the decisions, but we have to have that outstanding data. So well done to both of them. Let's absolutely. So Steve E. Smith, our Vice President for Instruction and Workforce Education, is now known as Cheesy. Steve Cheesy Smith. Mr. Smith received the Texas Association of Community Colleges Leadership Award this summer in Corpus Christi. The award recognizes administrators with outstanding leadership qualities who have made a significant impact on higher education. So well done to Mr. Smith. He continues to do that on a daily basis. Absolutely. So a couple of other, and I'm going to go through each one individually, but every time I see this picture, it reminds me of someone. So I know that she's watching because she texts me that she would be watching this streamline. That is Miss Rachel Viramontes. So everyone, please keep her in your thoughts as she continues to recover. We look forward to her coming back soon. So Pam, as I thanked earlier, who did a tremendous job with this presentation, this is the first one, the first State of the College address that Rachel didn't do in the last 18 years. So we certainly, I know you're watching, we want you to come back soon, get better, and we look forward to welcoming you back soon. But Rachel, along with Claudia and Minerva and Patty and Carrie and Dr. Michelle Watkins and Crystal, were all our Excellence Award winners. They are actually inaugural Excellence Award winners. They are the first ones to have EPCC's logo as part of the award. This is a tradition that we have begun. We will continue to move forward, but congratulations to the 2018 EPCC Excellence Award winners, and Rachel was one of them as well. Our Employees of the Year. So again, I can't thank these folks enough, and you're recognized by your peers, and so kudos to each of you, Cheryl Bowman, Norma Hinojos, Ivan Flores, and Ramona Fala. Congratulations for being recognized as the Employees of the Year this particular year. Well done and excited. I want to talk a little bit now about our district. And talk about what we're doing at the college as a whole. And so I'm going to talk about each of the respective vice presidential areas and the folks that have the misfortune of having to report directly to me. I've already talked about Pam, so she's gotten that as well. But IT, let's start with Dr. Heron and her team. These are the areas of information technology at El Paso Community College. Let's talk a little bit about what we're doing with our network systems and support services. And those of you that attend the board meetings, you know that Mr. Uxer will ask regularly, is this the technology that we need and that is going to be able to take us to the future? Not for the next year, but for the next many years or decades and beyond. And technology is changing so fast. So we have to make sure that we keep up. And wireless is something that's moving forward. So the network systems area has been working on phase four of development and configuration of the new wireless infrastructure. The project completion expectation is this fall. And I know that as soon as they finish that, we'll be saying it doesn't go fast enough. So they'll be working on the next iteration, but well done and excited about that. Marcos and Abraham and all of their respective team, thank you all so much. In addition, our desktop computers and printer deployment, they are working, technical support areas working on deploying over 700 computers and printers across the district. Again, I have been in higher ed long enough, as I've told you all to remember, if only I had a 386. It's just, yeah, this is more powerful than that 386 was. And so we continue to move forward. We continue to go forward with all of these areas. Again, thank you to the team for deploying those. And again, as soon as those are deployed, I'm sure the next IT project will come forward. DegreeWorks is up and running again. A lot of kudos to Dr. Iron, to Abraham Huvant, to Dr. La Chica Chavez and their respective teams for getting this most updated degree software system up and running so that we can move forward and students can know where they are on their particular degree plan and on their path. You're going to hear me speak of pathways as well, to be able to move forward and quickly without wasting any credits. We don't want students taking more than they need to take for their respective degree or certificate. Along with that is Civitas Learning. So Illum, I know that we talked about the data and we looked at the data very closely and we've verified all of the data. So training, retraining for this particular tool is moving forward. This will also help us as we move forward with degree maps so that students will be able to have their degree work information feeding into DegreeMap on the phone, so that app is available for them and they direct that at all times. Excited about that. So all of those trainings will be coming forward. I want to thank Mr. Ebert and his team at EPCC TV for doing a new show, Their Stories. And you see several of the folks, three of those, one employee and three board members that were featured on Their Stories. This is a new program produced called Their Stories. This episode that featured these four ladies, these leaders, it was broadcast as part of Women's History Month. A second episode featured a diverse group of women and their many accomplishments as well. If you didn't get to see it, it is on our YouTube channel. So I encourage you to be able to look at that. Another story, The Docket. And it is exactly what you think. It is a new show on legal issues. So you'll see more of this and more news will come of this as we go forward during the year. But you see that they focused on DWIs as well as immigration law along the border. And so this is another outstanding effort by EPCC TV to continue to keep our community informed of all issues that are pertinent to the community. You heard her earlier. I had to move the mic down after both Carrie Moe and Dr. Penley were here. Yes, so I wanted to make sure that I provide a proper congratulations to Dr. Penley, who was just hired last month officially by the Board of Trustees approving it as the Vice President for Research, Accreditation, and Planning. She is the Vice President for RAP. So I'm waiting, instead of the dance, I'm waiting for your RAP to come up next session, next Professional Development Day. I look forward to that. Let's talk a little bit about research, accreditation, and planning. So again, you heard earlier, learning about the community as a community. Dr. Quiroz, well done. That QEP report is done. Dr. Quiroz and Dr. Penley and others told me in last December, vote no. We don't want to do another QEP. Vote no. And so we didn't have a choice to vote no. It was either this kind of QEP or this kind of QEP. So we voted yes, and we will move forward with planning our next QEP. And everyone needs to be involved. In addition, Mary Beth Hahn, who I'm sure I doubt is here, and if she's here, she's probably sleeping because the fifth-year report just went out. And so we're certainly excited that fifth-year report went out. And again, you heard about the substantive change. I have another slide on that later in the presentation, but well done on both of those. Dr. Stroud and Ms. Frescas, institutional effectiveness and institutional planning. These are incredibly important. And I know, because I get caught in the whirlwind and I get busy in the day-to-day, and yet if you don't document it, it didn't happen. So we need to make sure that we continue to do this. Planning is not every 5 years or every eighth year as we get ready for our next visit by SAC-COC. Planning is a part of what we do. And so we need to make sure, and kudos to each of them for the great work that they do in these particular areas. Dr. Kay and her team in institutional research. We're moving forward with two surveys this fall, the SENSE survey. So I always used to tease Dr. McClenney that I was SENSE before SENSE was cool, because actually I studied the first 2 weeks of a semester, and that was part of my research. And then SENSE, they were smarter than I am, and they developed a survey that we have to pay for to ask students about the first few weeks of their particular enrollment at any institution of higher ed. What the data tells us is if they don't make it in those first 2 weeks, we may lose them completely. And so that's what we're looking at, is we're looking at SENSE. In addition, we're also moving forward with Dr. Sarah Goldrick-Robb's survey, Real College Survey. We want to know how many of our students are dealing with food insecurity. Nationally, 52% of students deal with food insecurity. They're hungry. So we want to know what's going on with our students, and we're going to find out a lot. And we're not going to be able to solve it all at once, but we're committed to working on it. This is another one that the Board of Trustees, Mr. Uxter in particular, has been adamant about. SGA has been a leader on this with the food pantries. There is more to do, and we will continue to move forward with that work. I want to welcome, so this is his first fall faculty development or professional development day as well. Dr. Kenneth Gonzalez, we hired Dr. Gonzalez in December of last year to be our Vice President for Student and Enrollment Services. So welcome, Dr. Gonzalez. Those are the areas within Student Enrollment Services. Let's talk a little bit about those areas. So what are we going to do? You heard Ms. Mo talk about the 50th anniversary, four marquee events that we're going to have during that particular area. Well, here's one of them. We will host the NGCAA Half Marathon Championships in 2019. So we had to pitch that we could host it. We had to have the person come in from the NGCAA. We had to host them, take them around to see what the race would look like in this particular area. And so Mr. Hinojosa, Ms. Mo, kudos. They said, absolutely, we would love to have the race here in El Paso. So it'll be here in 19, and then we're going to have it here again in 21. So we're going to host it two different times. Kudos to all of you. We look forward to it. No pressure, Mr. Nosa. It would be wonderful if we win the race while we're here. I know you're working on that already. Chief Ramirez and his team. So we are looking forward and moving with a community policing in action project. We are very fortunate that we have little to no crime on our campuses. We want to make sure we keep it that way. And so Chief Ramirez and his team are moving forward with really implementing community policing at all of our campuses and sites. The safety and security of our students, faculty, and staff is paramount to the board and I, and we want to make sure that we continue to move forward with that. So we're certainly excited about that work. A VIP enrollment program. So Student Enrollment Services, again, my thanks to each of you all that are leading this particular effort. This is going to be modeled after Operation College Bound that, again, I will touch on in just a moment. But we're looking at a true one-stop and getting students to do this as soon as possible and to move forward in getting everything done in a day, not coming back and forth. Not coming for one thing and then getting an appointment for another thing 2 weeks later, but getting the whole enrollment process. And it's not an easy process. You think about from application of admissions for financial aid, testing, counseling and guidance, actual registration, everything in a VIP moment. So kudos to them for moving forward and developing that. And we look forward to what that's going to come forward when it comes to fruition. New student orientation. We have to get students on the right track immediately. And believe it or not, orientation is a retention tool. It is not a recruitment tool. They're already ours. Now we need to make sure that they continue and they're successful. So more than 4,000 students, 95% said that they would recommend the new student orientation to all of our students. 88% said that NSOs made them excited to start college at EPCC. So to Alex Guerrero and his team, as well as to our counselors, well done. Now I know you're shooting for 100%, and I look forward to that. But well done to get that kind of number to come through. So congratulations on that. Dr. Gonzalez, Dr. Giron, and their respective teams. We partnered with Socorro Independent School District. They were the first to say yes. Now we're going to expand this to the other school districts, in particular the other two of the big three. And we conducted what we call Operation College Bound this past spring. We went to each of the six comprehensive high schools at Socorro Independent School District. We took a team. We took all the technology, all the equipment. We helped them apply for any institution, and we partner with UTEP. It wasn't just EPCC. And we helped them apply for any public institution in the state of Texas. If they had already applied and happened to be at EPCC, we helped them with financial aid. If they had done both of those, we provided counseling and guidance. And if they did all of that, we registered them on the spot for summer and fall. And we had 1,163 students participate just with EPCC, 749 registered on the spot. And so as a result of this, we saw a 6% increase in the number of applications that we received at the institution. So well done to each of them and their teams. Part of what we want to make sure as we move forward with pathways at the institution is that career and transfer services is a very powerful part of what we do. So we want to make sure that part of the pathway is that you have declared what you think your career should be, and that helps you with your meta major. And so if you go through this particular area, this past year they hosted 222 events, 3,000 participants. They also unveiled the Tejano Career Closet. And this allows students to be able to provide our students with professional clothing for interviews and networking events to make a positive first impression. Well done, and thank you to Carla Cardosa and her team. We look forward to expanding these particular programs so that students know what their career pathway is. So Carrie unveiled this and is certainly excited about this. It is a beautiful logo, and so kudos to our staff who designed it. Well done. Now two logos, EMSTI and the 50th. I thank you in particular for not copywriting it and tell us that we have to pay you every time we use it. So we appreciate that. 50 years is a remarkable achievement. We have been around now, created in 1969, this institution. Imagine this community without our five campuses and our respective sites. Imagine this community without the 78,000 degrees and certificates that we have awarded in those 50 years. So we're certainly excited, and we want to make sure that we celebrate and that the community understands the role that we have played in the progress of this wonderful community. So again, let me thank Carrie Moe and Lisa Elliott, who are serving as co-chairs, and you see all of the district-wide representation on all of the committees: publicity, community outreach, student engagement, our commencement committee, history and archives committee, and then of course, all of this leads to what? It all leads to major fundraising and alumni events. So we want to make sure that everyone has that wonderful opportunity to be able to understand what we have done in this community and what we're planning to do for the next 50 years. Part of that is telling our story. So our website on the master plan construction, all of the groundbreakings, the community forums, the annual report that we produced. I had a colleague from Educate Texas say that was one of the best annual reports that he has ever received. So kudos to the college and to Carrie Moe and her team, absolutely. We will continue to market the institution. We will continue to tell our story and show the faces of the students that call EPCC their first choice to begin their journey in higher education. Pride Wednesdays. I know all of you are incredibly proud. I see all of the purple shirts in the audience. Well done. I have seen a lot of teal in the audience as well. Pride Wednesdays. So those of you all that are wearing purple and teal, let me just say today's Thursday. But that's why I'm not wearing purple or teal, because today's Thursday. I follow the rules. So, but kudos to you all for having more than one purple or teal shirt. And so we look forward to everybody celebrating Pride Wednesdays. Ismael de la Rosa is spearheading that. Well done. I know Dr. Gonzalez and your team, you as well as Carrie Moe, have been instrumental on moving those forward. So we're excited about that. Again, we are measuring everything. So we were mentioned on average 15 times per week in the news during this past year. Those are good stories, not anything bad. 15 good news stories, and we appeared in more than 500 print media mentions, more than 350 TV news segments, and we haven't even talked about social media. I see all of you, I follow you all on Twitter regularly. Those of you all that follow me, thank you. So that it's not just my family following me. And we're excited about it. We need to make sure that the community knows the great work we're doing, and this is part of what we're doing as well. Mr. Bob Elliott and his team, just over $6.3 million. Well done. Absolutely. You see some of the grants that we're highlighting there, from the $83,000 from the Susan Harwood program to the $651,000 from the Mellon Foundation, and many in between to reach that $6.3 million. Congratulations and well done to each of you all. We look forward to that continuing. Let me talk a little bit about Dr. Gross and her team for the foundation. $215,000 of scholarships this past year, 176 students. 57% of those students that receive scholarships are graduating within 3 years. Just outstanding work. You see all the number of students that have received help since from the foundation since 2010, over 1,600. Again, certainly proud of that work. Well done, and excited about more work. I will end the presentation talking about a certain piece that is coming up soon so that everyone knows that. Let's talk a little bit about financial and administrative operations. Ms. Shaughnessy and her respective team, the great work that they do. Everything that we do at the institution is going to take resources. We do our best to make sure we utilize those resources and that we do it effectively and efficiently. Ms. Shaughnessy and her team do an outstanding job of that. The external audit results for fiscal year 2017. Again, no material weaknesses, no significant deficiencies. These are fancy things to say. It was a clean audit. So congratulations to Mr. Flores, to the budget staff, to Ms. Shaughnessy, Vice President Shaughnessy, all of the financial services staff. Those are the kinds of audits, in particular when we're dealing with our fiscal resources, that we want to ensure that we continue to have. They did that. Congratulations. Let's talk about our rating. So every few years, we have a rating. When we were going for the bond, we had to redo our ratings. And then a couple of years later, we came forward. This is S&P Global. We received an A-plus rating with a stable outlook. These are not easy accomplishments, and they're incredibly important because you've heard us talk about a 2020 bond. And until the Board of Trustees says it's going to happen, it's just a plan. But when they say it's going to happen, then we have to move forward, and our bond rating will play a key role in us moving forward with that. But we're certainly excited about that and all the work. So again, Ms. Shaughnessy, Mr. Flores, and all of your teams that worked on that, well done. Dr. Pena in Human Resources moved forward. The Board of Trustees made it clear to us that the applicant tracking system and the software that we had was not adequate based on what they had heard from the community. We heard that loud and clear. We moved forward with implementing NeoGov, an HR solution for higher education, a web-based recruitment, position, and performance management system. That has been implemented. And we're moving forward with that system now. So again, thank you, Dr. Pena, to you and your team. A commitment to diversity. This is also part of finance. So finance has more than just the dollars and cents, so to speak. They have done, Ms. Chavez and the diversity committee have done an outstanding job once again. It was great to see you on the 50th anniversary video. But the Safe Zone training that we're moving forward with, they hosted John Quinones for Hispanic Heritage Month. What would you do? Unfortunately, I had to be out of town, but I heard it was an outstanding event. Black History Month continues to move forward. Lots and lots of events to celebrate the diversity of our region, of our institution, of our student body. Certainly excited about that work and really pleased with what you're seeing. They are going to move forward with new workshops. Diversity, what does it matter to you? Obviously, Women's History Month that they celebrated this past March. Again, 40 women received 40 of our Diamond Awards to 40 EPCC women employees. And to date, nearly 350 have received that award. So certainly excited about that great work. Diversity, just like the college, if we don't celebrate it, who will? And so we need to make sure that we continue to do this. Dr. Brown. Dr. Brown and the Leadership Academy continues to move forward and doing great work. 27 graduated this past December. The class of 18 kicked off in January of this year, and we continue to move forward with an outstanding program. So Dr. Brown, kudos to you and the committee, and kudos to the folks that are participating in this particular class. We look forward to speaking to you. Part of what, again, Ms. Shaughnessy's area looks at is the arts. The El Paso Chopin Piano Festival. Again, you see all the events that are moving forward with that and have been in the past. This is 24 years of hosting this particular event. And so Dr. Scarborough, the founder and artistic director, and her committee continue to do an amazing job, and we're excited to be a part of that. Miss Janine Rudnick, really excited about this, the K through 12 art exhibit. And so well done for all of our students in our local school districts to have an opportunity to participate and to receive the accolades that they so well deserve. So the young man who has glasses on saying with his finger over his mouth, that was the presidential award winner. It looks a lot like my son, so I'm sure that influenced my pick. But it was really well done. It's not him, but it sure looked like him. Let's talk a little bit about Mr. Smith's area, instruction and workforce education, and all of the great work that they're doing. And this is just gonna highlight a segment, as I have, of each of the respective areas of the institution. But that's a huge portfolio that he and his team oversee. Dual credit is a big part of that portfolio. We have built the infrastructure that dual credit needs. You heard that earlier based on what SAC-COC, they recognize that as well. Not only the infrastructure, but ensuring that the professional development opportunities are available for that faculty. Our dual credit program is now larger probably than 20 community colleges in Texas, than the community colleges as a whole. We're nowhere near the largest program, but we have a robust program. And we do a great job of ensuring that they have professional development opportunities. You see a sampling of that, the fifth annual Building Bridges Conference. We had the second annual summer conference convening. We had a spring forum, and we continue to and now have a counseling institute, so that the counselors at the school district are working with the counselors at the college to ensure that they know and that those students are also on the right path. Dr. Escamilla continues our great work with Achieving the Dream. So we were around one Achieving the Dream institution when the movement began in 2004. We have been a Leah Maya Austin Award winner. We are a leader college, and we continue to do great work with that. Can't thank Dr. Escamilla and her team enough for coordinating with Dr. Diane Troyer, who continues as our leadership coach. Dr. Troyer was a founding faculty member at this institution, so it's always wonderful to bring her back. She provides a friendly, critical eye to the institution to push us to continue to move forward. So thank you, Dr. Escamilla. Our faculty, so Canvas kept coming, and I talked to other folks, and they were saying, Canvas is just so easy. And I said, well, that's our faculty's decision. The faculty committee met. They looked at Blackboard Learn and Canvas LMS. They evaluated those, and our faculty chose to continue to move forward with Blackboard. That is your decision. We look forward to it, excited about that. And this is going to continue to be a big part of what we do at the institution, as now 12,909 enrollments in distance learning. So kudos to our faculty as well as to Bob Jones for making sure that online learning is effective for our students. Ms. Lujan and our counselors and all of your team, the Early Alert Program continues to move forward and expand. Last fall, they saw a 91% persistence rate for students who participated being able to persist from the fall to the spring. 81% of those students are on good academic standing, and only 32% were placed on early alert status, compared to 40% that were not a part of the program. So you see the number of students, nearly 5,000 students have registered for that assessment that they're moving forward on the Success Navigator, and more than half have already completed that. So kudos to that. And so when we see something that's successful, we don't pilot things, we institutionalize them. Part of institutionalizing that is, where is the space? So a first year experience center is being created. It'll be part of the new STEAM building at the Valle Verde campus. So that is coming. We're excited about that particular area to continue to expand what we do with our students. Our partnership with Texas Mutual continues to move forward. Mr. Bogle, thank you for leading that, but all of the team that is involved. And Texas Mutual showcased the EPCC risk management program at their last endowment recipient. You all do such a great job. That partnership, they said they will continue to write that $100,000 check annually for us to continue with this program. So well done. Mr. Armendariz, And everyone at the Contractor Opportunity Center, $300,000 of grants this particular year. You see that they held over 44 events with over 1,700 attendees. So this is an outstanding program that we continue, that continues to be utilized by our community, so we're certainly excited about that great work. Our Small Business Development Center, Mr. Ferguson, you and your team continue to do a great job. That's why there is so much on that slide. Let me highlight a couple of things. 453 business clients counseled, 28 new businesses were assisted in starting, 18 expansion of existing businesses, 380 new jobs created, and 378 existing jobs retained as a result of the SBDC. $400,000 received to date. Well done and congratulations. This is a legislative priority, not just for EPCC, for all of the community colleges, because last session, SBDCs were on the chopping block. We can't get rid of them. We cannot cut them when they're doing such great work. So well done, Mr. Ferguson, you and your team. Dr. Farias and his team in Workforce Strategic Initiatives, WSIs, this is just a highlight of what they have done. Over $500,000+ of grants just this past year alone. We highlighted three of the largest ones, the Skills Development Fund, the SDF grant, and two different SDF grants, as well as apprenticeship grant. So kudos to the great work. Again, $500,000+ of grant dollars coming into the institution. Our Law Enforcement Training Academy, upgrading the firing range equipment. I want to make sure that if folks are going to have weapons, that they know how to use them properly. And this is one of the ways that we do that. So again, kudos to all of our team there, Mr. Bogle, and all of your folks working on that. I talked about the Bellin Foundation and the great work. This was a $2 million commitment to our region. $651,000 to the college, $1.3 million to UTEP. This is Margie Nelson Rodriguez and Brian Kirby, as well as many of our other English faculty members that moved this forward. And there's Caitlin Hernandez, who is one of the fellows that was identified to move forward. This is an outstanding project. The Mellon Foundation doesn't traditionally give to community colleges. So well done and excited about what this will do for our community. House Bill 2223, co-requisite model. Our faculty have done a tremendous job of implementing this. This fall, 25% of our developmental education courses are being delivered in a co-requisite model. Next fall, 50% have to be delivered in that fashion. And fall of 2020, 75% of our developmental courses have to be delivered in that fashion. Kudos to all of the team that's working on this. It is not easy work, and we certainly appreciate the great work. Pathways, we are now at Pathways 2.0. So every new student at the college is on a pathway this fall. There were 235 different pathways that were created by our faculty and staff. So now we're not satisfied just implementing them. We're saying, what is Pathways 2.0? And so Margie Nelson Rodriguez is leading this for our institution. We're working with Dr. Rob Johnstone and his team to make sure that we continue to move and raise the bar of student success. And we're doing that through Pathways 2.0. Our Prudential Mind Camp. We had 62 students participate in this. Dean Webb, Margie Nelson Rodriguez again, Ms. Fan Chen, Dr. Becky Escamilla, the STS department. All of these really focusing on students being able to be a part of the Prudential Mind Camp. What does that mean? The purpose of the camp was to engage students with math and its careers and to help create a pipeline of high school students to higher education math and IT programs. So excited that we're getting students young. They were from 10 to 18 to participate in this program. Let's talk a little bit about the master plan. So as I like to say, pardon our dust. We have construction underway at all five campuses. Those of you that are watching this streamed at the Rio Grande campus, no tomatoes at the screen, please. I know the parking issues. Everyone is dealing with the challenges of this, but I wanted to provide an update to everyone. Before I provide that update, I'd like to thank ECM, who is serving as our project manager for these and moving us forward. Ruben Gallardo is a point person, Rick Lobato, Ms. Shaughnessy and their teams of ensuring that these are on time and are, as Dr. Graham would say, ahead of schedule and under budget. We will settle for on time and on budget. Here's what we're looking at. The Via Verde Transportation Training Center, just an update, that total project is just under $11 million. The steel is up. We expect that to be ready for the fall of 19. So they're coming quickly. At this time next year, we will hopefully have had a ribbon cutting ceremony grand opening for it. Let's talk about the classroom, the STEAM classroom that we're building, 106,000 square foot building, $35.8 million project. That one will be ready in the spring of 2020. So we have a little over a year and a half to go for that particular project. We are looking at the Trans Mountain campus, Judge Haggerty. That project will be ready next fall of 19, $6.7 million approximately. We're moving forward with the Rio Grande campus. I know we're working and we continue to work with the city, with our own police department to, and we have actually plenty of space on those temporary lots that we need to make sure that students utilize those as well as overflow parking to be there. That is a $32.3 million project. That one will be the last project to come up in the fall of 2020. Now remember, that one is 65,000 square feet of classrooms and labs and 400 parking spaces. So in the fall of 2020, parking will not be an issue whatsoever. Let's continue on the last two projects. We already held the Northwest Campus groundbreaking. That is a $9.5 million project that will be ready in the spring of 2020. And the Mission del Paso, we've held that groundbreaking. That's a $17.5 million project that will also be ready in spring of 2020. We are building state-of-the-art classrooms and labs and technology so that our students are able to learn in the utmost and latest technology to help facilitate their success. We're certainly excited about these. I can't thank the campus deans for your leadership, as well as each of the respective planning committees that ensured that these had what we needed in there. Let's talk a little bit about the numbers of the district, and there's lots and lots of numbers to discuss. You all know that I have an affection for the data. I am knee deep in the data on a regular basis, and I always remember that there's a face behind every single data point. So this is one of the data points that is alarming to me. I'm a very proud Texan, third generation on one side, fourth generation on the other side. Don't know if the border crossed us or we crossed the border, but it happened at some point in time. And when I look at this, being a very proud Texan, I look at the national average. And remember that word, average. We are not an average institution. I don't believe that we're an average state. I think we're above those. And yet, I also have to understand the reality of what the data says. And so, there are 3.1 million high school graduates annually and growing. Now, I know the WICHE data. And other than the West and the South, all the region's high school graduates are going to go down. So we're not going down. We're going to produce, our state will continue to produce more high school graduates. But nationally, of those 3.1 million high school graduates, about 70% go to college. When you pull Texas out, and Texas accounts for nearly 11%, or about 335,000 graduates every year and growing, only 52% of our high school graduates go to college, any college, not EPCC, not UTEP, any institution of higher ed. We're more than 20. When you pull us out, the national average goes up to 72.2. Over 20% of our high school graduates do not go to college. That's below the national average. That's not acceptable to me. We have to continue to change that. We have to make sure that is an economic crisis waiting to happen in our state. And so we want to make sure that we continue to move forward with that. Now, why is that? Why does it happen? I get it. I know that we have a direct relationship with the economy. And for the first time, universities are starting to feel this pinch. It's my understanding UTEP has said that they don't believe that they'll make their enrollment projections for this fall. That'll be the first time in many, many years. Universities don't have traditionally a direct relationship with the economy as we do. So right now, we're about 200 students up. That's good news. We need that to grow. But we're at about 28,750 students, and our unemployment rate is 4.4%. But students are not, they're underemployed. We need to make sure that they have living wage jobs, not minimum wage jobs. We will continue to work on that with our partners in K-12, with our partners at UTEP, with each of you all, with telling our story and continuing to tell the story of what higher education means to the students that come through and are successful at our respective institutions. Now, enrollment has only increased 14% over the last decade. We've nearly doubled the number of degrees and certificates. And that's going to get harder because every year that we move this, the number in the previous year has grown. So 10 years ago, we were producing about 2,300 degrees and certificates. Now we're producing about 4,400. So we're going to continue to move forward and focus on completion, but we're not going to stop focusing on access. We need to make sure we do them both. This is completely attributed to the faculty and staff, all of the support staff, all of the leadership, but we have nearly doubled our graduation rate from the entering class of 2010 to the entering class of 2014. From 10.7 to 20.3, that is a 9.6 percentage point increase or a 90% increase in graduation rates. Now, we're not satisfied, but who else can say they've doubled it in the last 5 years? So kudos to each and every one of you. We will continue to focus on this and continue to ensure that that number continues to rise. This is our budget. So I want to make sure that everyone recognizes we operate a $145.4 million budget. So when I started in higher ed, it was a third, a third, a third. When Judge Hagerty started as a board member, 55% of our budget came from state appropriations. And in 1984, 72% of EPCC's budget came from state appropriations. It is less than 22% in this budget. Our taxpayers are now footing 41% of our budget, not because we continue to raise taxes, because fortunately our tax base continues to grow. And our students are now contributing nearly 32% of the budget. So that is how the revenue comes in. We're very transparent. This is how the revenue goes out. You see the respective areas. Those are purely faculty. When you see instruction, that is purely faculty salaries and benefits. You then start to add with them parts of institutional support, academic support that contributes to those. But those are the expenditures by function. And here are the expenditures by categories. So a full approximately 77% of our budget is salaries and benefits at the institution. In addition, if you take, we have to pay electricity. We don't have a choice. We have to pay for, and especially in the summer, we don't have a choice. All of the licenses, all of the software, all of those particular agreements. So when you look at our budget, there's a small percentage of the budget that is not already committed. Again, you see the detail in those particular areas. Let's talk a little bit more about some celebrations. This was the 12th. I kept saying 11th, and I was corrected. It is the 12th. Year in a row that El Paso Community College is ranked first in the nation in awarding associate degrees to Latino students. I always remind folks, absolutely, and congratulations. Now look how big people, and I've had people in the community say, oh, that's a reflection of who you serve. And I say, really? So Houston is the largest city in Texas. It is the most diverse city in Texas. It serves over a million Hispanic people, a million African-American, million Anglo individuals, and a very large Asian population as well. And we award more than Houston does, or than Lone Star does. And we could go on and on. Again, this is a tribute to you all. We're excited about that. That's the 12th year in a row. Again, I cannot thank Dr. Penley and her team enough for the great work. It is not easy. So 2012, we had a SACS team on site, SACS COC team on site. Yes, that was not when you were in charge, Dr. Penley, I heard you. And the board had to come forward, and we had to spend about $4.2 million to hire 50 additional full-time faculty. We are a stronger institution for that. They came back in 2015 specifically to look at our dual credit programs. They left with no findings and no recommendations. They came back this spring of 18, and they once again left with no finding and no recommendations. That is not an easy task. Kudos to everyone that was involved. I sent something out on the email system, and Mr. Flores, Aaron Flores, that is, thank you. You not only were there with the team, you were on call 24 hours. We put you up in a hotel so that if a printer didn't work or a computer didn't work, they could reach out to you and you could go and help them immediately. So thank you so much for your willingness to do that. 24-hour IT support on site for them. So certainly appreciate that. Next steps, as you heard earlier, the fifth year report has been submitted. And we also have 23 sites that goes in front of the board in December. So we will continue to work diligently at this, but I cannot thank everyone enough for the great work that they've done. Dr. Stroud, we are a community college. Kudos to you for continuing to lead this. Even if your president is fearful to donate blood, if any one of you all needed it, I would do it. But yeah, it wasn't a good situation 30 some years ago when I fainted giving blood. So we'll everyone else, thank you, Dr. Stroud. We continue to lead the region for 14 years in a row. 2,600 plus pints of blood donated by our employees, our staff, our faculty, and our students. Congratulations, absolutely. And I'm the universal donor. I'm O positive, so that's always in large supply, so no one worry about that. The CAFR Award is incredibly important, and 22 years in a row, that's unheard of. 22 years in a row, Ms. Shaughnessy, Mr. Flores, and their respective teams, Ms. Diaz and Budget, all of that team have received that recognition for that award 22 times in a row, and no pressure for the 23rd time. But we look for congratulations and well done. Chair Fierro, congratulations to you. You are now a trustee. The chair of our board was elected to serve on the Association of Community College Equity Committee, Trustee Equity Committee, as well as a director for the West Texas region for the State Association. It is vitally important that we are represented on these groups. So kudos to Chair Fierro. Oops, all right, sorry about that, folks. This is the latest, and we made sure that visiting team for SACS knew this. We are a finalist for Excellencia in Education as an example of Excellencia for our dual credit and early college high school programs. We're one of five associate degrees distributors that are nominated or selected as finalists. We will find out next month in DC if we are the winner. So kudos to everyone that's involved with it, and congratulations on being selected. And finally, let's talk a little bit about what's going to happen in that pink building in Austin starting on January the 10th of this year. I was on the 610 flight yesterday morning to Austin. I landed, went straight to the car rental, and got to the Capitol about 15 minutes after the hearings on dual credit began. I got there when Commissioner Paredes was still testifying in front of the Senate committee. Was the Joint Committee for Higher Ed and Public Ed together. Five panels. It lasted six and a half hours. It went from 9 to 2:49 in the afternoon. We followed that up with a TAC Legislative Committee meeting. So let's talk a little bit about what we're looking at. The board and I have already let the entire delegation, So our five representatives, as well as Senator Rodriguez, all know what our legislative agenda is for 19. We are focused on funding, we are focused on dual credit, and we are focused on workforce education. We've met with the entire delegation. On Monday was Chairman Pickett. He was the last of our legislators. We will now begin to meet with the county judge, both the sitting judge and the judge-elect, the county commissioners, the mayor, and all of the city representatives, city manager, both chambers of commerce. We will continue to let everyone know what our legislative agenda is. And so let me let you know what it is. It begins with funding. We're asking the legislature for an 8% increase in funding for the 50 community colleges. That equates to $144 million. It is focused on performance base. We're looking at student success points, and for the legislature to go from the current $173 per point to $215 per point. This would bode extremely well for our institution, as we've been laser focused on success for many, many years. We're looking at dual credit and asking the state to set a goal for dual credit of no less than 30% of high school graduates having earned at least 12 college hours before they graduate from high school. We're asking for a task force so that it's not one individual that makes a decision on how dual credit moves forward, but a task force made up of constituents from throughout the state, from the Workforce Commission, from the Coordinating Board, from TEA, as well as from universities and colleges and philanthropy. And finally, we're focused on workforce education. We have a direct role in this. And we are looking at expanding CTE offerings, both through dual credit as well as skills development funds being increased and the JET grant being increased. Let me get into a little bit more detail. So last session, the 50 community colleges received $1.767 billion of funding. We're recommending $1.909 billion. You see that the $83 million, that's a 5.5% increase in contact hours. That may be adjusted down. It is based on growth and inflation. If we don't grow, if those contact hours don't grow for the 50 community colleges, that number will come down. What will not go down is the $61.4 million to fund the additional request for student success points. We are in agreement with the coordinating board and with the formula advisory committee. So all three, TAC and those other two, are in agreement on these particular recommendations to the legislature. So when we meet with our delegation, as well as when we meet with state leadership, what they tell us is, well, if you ask for more, I've got to take it from somewhere else. And so we've even provided our recommendations on where they can take it from. Everybody wants to know? Okay. Yeah, I was born and raised in Brownsville, border city. I spent 16 years in McAllen before I moved to El Paso, another border city, and for the last, now in my seventh year of calling this beautiful region my home, I've never felt unsafe on the border. And yet we spend $800 million on border security, which is not a state responsibility, it is a federal responsibility. So what one of the representatives told me is, well, you've already been beat because we need some of that money for Hurricane Harvey. And what I shared with is, if a hurricane is not enough rain to touch the rainy day fund, then I don't know what is. And the rainy day fund will be over $12 billion in January. So that's where that money, that's where the Harvey money should come from. So we need to look at that. We will ask all of you in your respective areas to advocate on behalf of these requests from the legislature. Our faculty has a very strong faculty statewide association. I saw you, Ms. Bell. Our staff, you know, members of the delegation, our students, everyone, our employees at the institution. It is going to be a tough session, but unfortunately, I don't remember ever saying, oh, it's going to be a great session. They're all tough, and we'll continue to do what we need to do. We have to tell our story on workforce. The 50 community colleges produce 93% of all the technical degrees and certificates in our state. But we don't tell anyone we do that. Well, we're telling everyone we're doing that now. 54,000 degrees and certificates awarded by the 50 community colleges in those technical fields. These are workforce-ready, high-wage, high-skilled jobs. So we'll make sure that our legislature knows that. Dual credit, oh, it's a hot topic. So the reason that we're saying that it be, we set a goal is simply because here's some of the studies that came forward. So former state representative Mike Villarreal from San Antonio is now Dr. Villarreal. He did his whole dissertation on dual credit, the effects of dual credit on secondary and post-secondary student outcomes. And key findings are, you're welcome to read the whole report, but here's the Cliff Notes version for you. It provides evidence to policymakers to support high schools and colleges in aggressively expanding dual credit, increasing the amount of dual credit earned per student, and prioritizing dual credit courses that produce the largest effects. And any policy that looks at reducing dual credit to less than 30 hours would be detrimental to the state. So right now, about 21% of our high school graduates have 12 plus hours in our region. So there is still plenty of opportunity for us to do this. We've measured the data. So that's Dr. Villarreal's study. UT Systems and TAC did a study together, a task force that came forward. Here are the major policy recommendations from that task force. Create a statewide commission, sound familiar, that includes the tri-agencies, higher education, business stakeholders, et cetera. Establish that goal by 2030. No less than 30% of high school graduates will have earned 12 hours, and requiring that they declare a meta major by the 12th hour to make sure we move forward with that. AIR came forward and they did a study. Theirs has been the most controversial. Let me say on two of these studies that looked at rigor, there is no questioning rigor. Rigor has been put to bed and should be. There is no discernible differences existed in the content covered, the level of cognitive complexity demanded by student assignments, and the way in which instructor graded student work across high school dual credit instructors, traditional dual credit instructors, or traditional community college courses. Cost has been a big piece of this. Overall, our estimates suggest that on average, the benefits of dual credit education far exceed the cost. That was the AIR study. Finally, UT Systems, Dr. David Troutman was the lead author on UT Systems. The key findings there were compared to students who are not credit bearing at the time of college admission process, dual credit students are more likely to be retained and graduated from a UT system institution. They have higher first, second, and third year GPAs and have fewer semester credit hours at the time of graduation. This is not a silver bullet, but it is absolutely part of the silver buckshot for us to increase the educational attainment level in our region, bringing it closer to home. We now serve this past year 85, that is an annual enrollment. So not every semester, in fact, this semester we're serving about 7,400 students in dual credit, 227 credentialed teachers, 67 sites, 12 school districts, and 12 early college high schools. They outperform every other segment of the student body at EPCC, and here's the latest data. Over 8,200 dual credit students have now enrolled, former dual credit students have now enrolled at UTEP. They are 3.8 times more likely to graduate in 4 years, an additional 1.6 times more likely to graduate in 6 years. So collectively, nearly 5.5 times more likely to graduate in that 150% IPEDS timeframe. 50% of them continue into graduate school. So that number will continue to decline as that number continues to go up. But our students, again, I know dual credit is done everywhere throughout the state. I don't know where it's done better than it's done in El Paso. Kudos to all of you, absolutely. You all know that Nelson Mandela is one of my absolute heroes. And he talks about education and had spoken about it being the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Let's start with our region. And so you all are doing it on a daily basis. So on behalf of the Board of Trustees, I thank you for the great work that you do every single day. I hope that you have an outstanding fall semester. Let me remind you that Spring Professional Development Day will be here in the blink of an eye. That will be on Thursday, February 7th, 2019. Classes will be held. So let me also say that to the students who I know are not watching, but classes will be held. And then one last thing. This is an outstanding event. If you have not attended this event, I encourage you to attend it. So Dr. Gross and her team are having the third annual Fajitas and Margaritas Scholarships. Thursday, September 27th, tickets are available. They have raised $35,000 for scholarships. It's a great event. It's a fun event. If you can make it, I encourage you to come out. And again, thank you so much for all the work that you do. Have a great semester.